us of our sins, and make us aware of the promise of your Son, that where two or three are gathered together in his name, he is with them. Through this holy Eucharist we celebrate, make us worthy to sit at the table in the kingdom of heaven. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Senses, challenging us to embrace the glory of God
as we await our Savior's promised coming. And please say with me now the second form of the Confiteor. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, in the presence of the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. I ask the Blessed Mother Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God. As a penance for today's confession, I remind you during this third Sunday of Advent, God Death Sunday, joyful Sunday, let us bring joy to the people in our communities that so desperately seek it. If you have not yet contributed to one of the community efforts to provide for people in our community, that I invite you to do so. In our parish, now we are providing for the needs of our animal friends, for the pets and the shelters that provide for them. You may bring through this month a gift for them, but there are so many different organizations. There's Toys for Tots, there's the Make-A-Wish Foundation, there is the New Hampshire Food Bank. There are just so many ways that we can make this joy as we prepare for the coming of Christ, a joy that others who have little joy in their life can experience. So I would ask you to do something that would be of effect, beneficial to those who are in need in our community this day, and I would ask you to do that as your penance. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I do absolve you from all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Awake and sing, you who lie in the dust, for your dew is a dew of light, and the land of shades gives birth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without
end. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Pardon and freedom from the burden of our sins. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Rejoice with joyful song. The glory of Lebanon will be given to them, the splendor of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the hands that are feeble. Make firm the knees that are weak. Say to those hearts are frightened, be strong, fear not. Here's your God. He comes with vindication, with divine recompense. Comes to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, the ears of the deaf be cleared. Then will the lame leap like a stag, then the tongue of the dumb will sing. Those whom the Lord has ransomed will return and enter Zion singing, crowned with everlasting joy and gladness, sorrow and mourning will flee. This is the word of the Lord. See how the farmer awaits the precious yield of the soil? He looks forward to it patiently while the soil receives the winter and the spring rains. You too must be patient. Steady your hearts, because the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, my brothers, lest you be condemned. See, the judge stands at the gate. As your models in suffering, hardships, and impatience, brothers, take the prophet who spoke in the name of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, in your
mercy cleanse me so that I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. Sent a message through his disciples to ask him, "Are you he who is to come, or do we look for another?" In reply, Jesus said to them, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind recover their sight, cripples walk, lepers are cured, the deaf hear, dead men are raised to life, and the poor have the good news preached to them. Blessed is the man who finds no stumbling block in me." As the messenger set off, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. "What did you go out to the wasteland to see? A reed swaying in the wind? Tell me, what did you go out to see? Someone luxuriously dressed? Remember, those who dress luxuriously are to be found in royal palaces. Why then did you go out? To see a prophet? A prophet indeed, and something more. It is about this man that Scripture says, 'I send my messenger ahead of you to prepare your way before you.' I solemnly assure you, history has not known a man born of a woman greater than John the Baptizer. Yet the least born into the kingdom of God is greater than he." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, dwell within us.
Manchester, New Hampshire. To all of you, I say, good morning.
Good morning.
Very good. Today is Gaudete Sunday. Rejoice. Rejoice again, I say rejoice. Let the dew come down and bear a Savior. The Old Testament and the New Testament talk about the coming of Christ. But the Old Testament speaks in words and in illustrations that the Hebrew folk would understand. The Old Testament tells us that the precursor of the Messiah would be Elijah the prophet coming again, and that the Messiah would be he who would lead the Hebrew people and all people of the world, that the Hebrew nation would be the first among all nations, and that God would lead them through this Messiah, this Messiah, and it would all begin with the appearance of the prophet Elijah. In the New Testament, in Jesus' own words, we hear that John the Baptist was he who was supposed to be God's messenger ahead of him to prepare Jesus' way before him. The last line of today's, or the next to the last line of the gospel reading for today says, a prophet indeed and something more. It is about this man that Scripture says, John the Baptist. That Scripture says, I send my messenger ahead of you to prepare your way before you. So we are being told that the advent of the Messiah is already present, because John the Baptist, the form of Elijah, who spoke in the spirit and the power of Elijah, who called the people to confess their sins and return to their God, that he was already among them, and that meant that the Messiah was near, Jesus Christ. And indeed he was present, and he would offer himself on the cross for the sins of the world, so that all men might be freed through faith in him. And so it is interesting, because even in the readings today, in the Old Testament, we hear the words in the very beginning of this portion of the book of the prophet Isaiah, the desert and the parched land will exult. The steppe will rejoice and bloom. They will bloom with abundant flowers and rejoice with a joyful song. The glory of Lebanon will be given to them, the splendor of Carmel and Sharon, and they will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. In other words, God is going to manifest himself before the people, and he's going to do it in marvelous ways before their very eyes. He is going to make the desert bloom. He's going to make the desert bloom, and he's going to give splendor to the mountains of Israel, to God's precious mountains, to the very mount on which the temple sits. And it says further, strengthen the hands that are feeble, make firm the knees that are strong, say to those whose hearts are frightened, be strong and fear not, here is your God. In the New Testament, in the Gospel, we see these messengers who were sent by God to find out who Jesus was. Is he indeed the Messiah? Because John baptized him, but then Jesus went and began his ministry while John continued his ministry at the Jordan, and eventually he was arrested by Herod, put into prison, and this is before the beheading of John in the prison, obviously. But John wants to know, is this the Jesus? Is this he who was baptized? Is this truly the Messiah? And Jesus says that indeed it is he, because he, you can tell by the miracles that are being wrought by him. The blind recover their sight, cripples walk, lepers are cured, the deaf hear, and dead men are raised to life. And we are being told, in the messengers of John are being told to go back to John and tell them, yes, indeed, the Messiah is here. And all of the world, John's disciples, Jesus' disciples, the people of the Hebrew nation, were all waiting for the Messiah. That's why on the moment of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, just before his death, the people shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, repeating, echoing the words of Isaiah. And yet this Jesus who came to save his people, saved them in a way that they weren't expecting, because he died on the cross. But he resurrected 3 days later, but the people did not believe. And Jesus said, only those who believe have the opportunity to be saved, that I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. And Jesus also told his disciples before he ascended into heaven, wait, I will send you the Holy Spirit, but I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there also you may be. He said that to the disciples in the upper room. And Thomas then said, How are we supposed to know where you're going? How do we know that? And Jesus then said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And so we are told to wait. But waiting is a very hard thing to do, especially for a human being. All of us are called in our lives just for material things, just for things that have to do with our own lives, perhaps our own families, our work situations. Many times we're told, be patient. Be patient. It's all going to work out in the end. But those two words, be patient, are very hard for us to accept because we're impatient. We want things and we want them now. But scripture also tells us that in God's time, a day can be like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years can be like one day. Jesus' promise holds true, but we must be patient. As Paul says in the letter to the Romans today, be patient, my brothers, until the coming of the Lord. Be patient until the coming of the Lord. And then he gives the example, see how the farmer awaits the precious yield of the soil. He looks forward to it patiently while the soil receives the winter and the spring rains. It's a good thing most of us aren't farmers, because we'd plant the seed and we'd expect the entire crop to be gathered in tomorrow. But a farmer understands the way that nature works. He understands the way that crops are grown. And we are called to understand that this is how the kingdom of God is prepared for Christ to return on this earth. Do not grumble against one another, my brothers, lest you be condemned. Don't be impatient. Don't be impatient with your fellow Christians. Don't be impatient with the people that you live with, but exercise that gift of God, that gift of the Holy Spirit, which is patience. And God will come in his time. And for those who are patient and wait for him, the blessings shall be great indeed. So the message of the church on this joyful third Sunday of Advent, this Gaudete Sunday, is be patient. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now let us rise and let us together proclaim the faith that we share. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. A man named Receive, Father, almighty and eternal God, this man who was which I am with his servant on for you, my living and true God, for my countless offenses and iniquities, for all your present for our nation, as well as for all Christians living in dead and for all humanity. May it be for us a means to salvation and everlasting life. Lord God, we are
unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God.
presence, these holy and spotless sacrifices which we offer to you, in the first place for your holy Catholic Church, that you would guide it in peace, defense, and unity throughout the whole world, with its bishops and priests, especially Anthony, our prime bishop, my brother bishops, and all who profess the true Orthodox and Catholic faith which comes to us from the apostles. Remember your servants, Lord, and all here present whose faith and devotion are known to you, for whom we offer, who offer up to you this sacrifice of praise for themselves and all their own, for their hope of salvation and deliverance, and who freely choose to serve you, the living, eternal, and true God. If we join in communion with and honor above all others the memory of Mary, the glorious Virgin Mother of our Lord and God, Jesus Christ. Also your blessed apostles, martyrs, and confessors, together with all the countless number of saintly men and women of all nations who lived, suffered, and died for the glory of your name and the coming of your kingdom. May the remembrance of these praiseworthy people encourage us to follow their heroic example, making us worthy of your grace and love through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We ask you, Lord, to graciously accept our offering and that of your whole family, and so order our days in your peace that we may be saved from spiritual damnation and counted among the flock of your chosen people through Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, we ask you to bless, to accept, and to confirm this offering, to make it pleasing to yourself, so that it may be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. The day before his path, suffering and death, in order to manifest his infinite love to his disciples and through them to all who would believe in him, to fill the hearts of his followers with the fire of his love, draw them to himself, make them joyful, and save them, he instituted these holy mysteries in which, spiritually and bodily, in his entire being, he again lives among his people. At that solemn moment, so sacred for the whole human family, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is broken for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again, giving thanks to you, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Therefore, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son, our Lord, and his blessed Passion, Resurrection, and his glorious Ascension, we, your servants and faithful people, offer to your Divine Majesty from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to regard these offerings with favor and joy, and accept them as you receive the gifts of your just servant Abel, the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and that which your high priest Melchizedek offered you, a holy sacrifice and immaculate host. We humbly ask Almighty God, command that this offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your high altar, into the presence of your divine majesty, that we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and sleep in peace. We remember especially the soul of our departed sister, Lena Frances Botor. We also pray for the soul of Helen Kuliga, whose funeral will take place in our cathedral this Wednesday. To these souls, Lord, and all who rest in Christ, grant we pray a place of refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ, our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, with him, and in him, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Christ, who said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church. And grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns God forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment or condemnation, though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may it become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this holy communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last entirely unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this, who lives and reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul to everlasting life. Amen. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy, behold, the Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Body and the blood of Christ. Amen. received with our lips, the way we understand with our minds, and may the temporal gift become for us an everlasting healing. May your body, which I have received, and your blood, which I have drunk, cling to my innermost being, and grant that no sin remain in me, and these holy sacraments are nourished, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord raises up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord protects the stranger, sustains the orphan and the widow, but thwarts the way of the wicked. Peace be with you. Let us pray. Lord our God, we thank you for the coming of your Son in this holy Eucharist. Open our eyes to the needs of the sick and the poor. For unless we see him in our brothers and sisters, we will never recognize his final coming. We ask this in the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Shelters, and we hope that you will provide for them also during these during this Christmas time of giving. And I remind you too that on Wednesday the choir will be having the rehearsal, that we will be having our adult Bible study at 7 o'clock, and you are all invited to be a part of that. The information is in the bulletin. If you would like to participate from your home, simply contact me. You should have already received the information in a notice that was sent out with a hyperlink for the study if you would participate in Zoom. For the rest of the announcements, they are in the parish bulletin. And a final reminder that next Sunday too, our Seniorate will be having its annual Seniorate candlelight service. That will take place at Holy Cross Parish in Central Falls, Rhode Island. Karen and I will be participating. If there's anybody else who would like to participate in that candlelighting service, we can give you directions, or if you need a ride, you can always join with us. I thank you again for your attendance today, and I wish you all a blessed third Sunday of Advent, God Dead Sunday. Karen.